of all the things that you've had to encounter, like what is the most life threatening thing? I mean, because you were in some bad situations with different militant groups and stuff like that. And
I think it was probably out of all those things, the car accident probably is the closest that I've come to losing my life, because in all of the other circumstances, you've got some element of control. Even on the front lines in Iraq, where we are sort of embedded with the troops who are fighting against ISIS, you know, it's quite an intense experience when you're getting ambushed by ISIS, but at least you can kind of like duck behind a tank or whatever it might be to like, you feel a little element of control. And particularly, you know, if you've been in the military, you have a certain training and instinct that comes with that to do what you can to stay safe, right?
Yeah.
Whereas when the brakes on your, you know, we got in a taxi in Nepal because we couldn't stay in this particular village one day. And we were driving over these mountains at night and the brakes just failed on this.
Were you driving?
No. So we got to this village and basically there was nowhere to stay because there was like a Maoist communist sort of uprising. And they were like, look, they were very polite, these guys, but they said, look, you can't stay here, but there's another village 5 miles away. And my friend in his taxi will take you. So it was myself, my brother who'd come to visit me, and my local guide, Bernard. And we got in this taxi. And as we were heading over the mountains, it was like super dark. The brakes just failed as we were going downhill, and heard it. And that moment then that was terror. That was real terror, because I knew what was going to happen. I knew that the walls there, the cliff on one side was like 400 feet drop into a jungle ravine, and there was nothing I could do. Absolutely nothing.
We were recently on our way up to Hunza and we made the drive from Islamabad to the Hunza Valley.
Those roads are lying,
So the KKH highway, it's one of the most dangerous roads in the world. And we were on the way up there. By the time we actually hit that part of the highway that was with the cliffs and the ravines, it was dark, midnight type of thing, and you couldn't really see. But you knew that cliff was there. And it wasn't until the next day when we were coming back that we realized how narrow these roads were. And on top of it, the funny thing is that we were in Pakistan. We had this driver who, we were on this 4-lane highway leaving Islamabad, and we're getting passed by donkeys pulling carts. Were we not, Jonathan? And then
it was ridiculous how slow they were going on the highway.
Then we get on this back road, this part of the KKH highway where it's not even paved, and it's midnight, dark, and for the occasional car that we came to, this guy's overtaking cars and passing people, and I'm scratching my head like, why were we driving so slow on the highway? I asked the guy, and he said, well, you know, we're concerned about safety. The next day when we were driving back, and it was actually sunny, and you could see really how narrow the road was, how close you were to those edges. And so, I saw the car, I saw a picture of the car that was wrecked. And I mean, truly lucky to, I don't believe in the word luck, but I'll just use it as a phrase, like lucky to walk away from some of that. You broke your humerus, right?
Yeah, I broke my arm. Got a pretty big scar from, I don't know if you can see that from there. It was, you know, I was very, very fortunate to survive that. I mean, like I say, 400 foot drop straight into the jungle. How we survived, I don't know. You know, it was a real miracle. And to be, the fact that we were probably a mile away from the nearest village, but the local people had heard the car going off the cliff and they came and rescued us. So I feel, you know, forever indebted to these guys that came and rescued us.
They took care of you at their place too. Like
they took us in for like 3 days. The problem was we couldn't get a helicopter to take us out because of the it was the monsoon season, so it was really heavy rain and so I just got, you know, a lot of morphine and then I had to ride it out for 3 days. And it was pretty intense. But that for me was probably the standout moment of when I was convinced I was going to die. Yeah.
It's crazy of all the things you've gone through, like, talking about jumping over tails of crocodiles and things like that. And then it's the car wreck, right?
Or being held at like a gunpoint, right? In Sudan. Yeah. Like that's like, maybe you could talk a little bit about that. Cause I mean, some of the things that stood out were incidents, you know, where you found yourself in these situations, whether it's in Bor in South Sudan, in the middle of, like, of an attack that was going on, the civil unrest that was going on, or sure. even being in the mosque when the there was a police raid, right, with the they were looking to pick up the Muslim Brotherhood. Kind of what was that experience like?
Yeah, I mean, those sorts of experiences, I guess because I'd been in the military, it wasn't all, you know, it wasn't sort of entirely unexpected. So I'd seen things like that before. You know, I'd been in combat before. So there's a sense of, there is still a sense that you, there's something you can do about it. And I think that's the major difference. Although it's a very different prospect when you're, you know, for example, you know, 2 years ago when I was in the Middle East in Iraq, and we were on the front line of the war against ISIS, you know, being there just with a camera, is a different prospect to when you're a soldier, because of course, if you're there with the military, if something, you know, you'd hope that if something bad went wrong, then at least you've got medical support. You've got a helicopter to go and rescue you. You've got your buddies there, around you.
You've got your
when
rifle.
You're there as a, yeah, exactly.
I saw video of that where you're in the back of the truck and you're like, yeah, that's incoming. And then you, like, you put a flak jacket on and then you end up jumping out of the truck. And I'm like, oh great, he's got a camera. Like, how helpless. I would feel so helpless at that point in time.
Yeah, I mean, it sounds weird. It sounds kind of odd, but I guess anyone that's been in the military will sort of recognize it. It's quite a thrilling feeling. It's a sense of, you know, it gets your heart pounding. There's a sense of adrenaline that is probably, you know, something that can't be replicated anywhere else. And I wouldn't describe myself as a thrill seeker, and I wouldn't go looking for those sorts of environments if, you know, if it wasn't part of the job. But there is something quite, when you live on the edge, when you're constantly alert, as you well know, it's a feeling that it's very difficult to find anywhere else. And for me, I think being in those situations, reporting back and documenting them is part of the job. And yes, it comes with risks, and yes, it can be terrifying at times, but, I enjoy the challenge of being in those situations and, I suppose testing myself, in the process.
I particularly, when you say that, it reminds me of the story of, when you were in Egypt, when you came in and they were confiscating your stuff and all your pictures. And then at first you were playing like a dumb tourist, and then you flipped the switch to, like, you took control of the situation and was like, I'm just going to roll I'm going to roll a dice here. Tell the story, because it's hilarious.
Oh yeah. I mean, so we got to the Egyptian border having crossed over from Sudan, and the local police basically just took me in. They were like, who are you? What are you doing? And I've been to Egypt like 5 times. And I think every time I'd been detained for like some spurious thing, you know, just like they just like to like question people.
Yeah.
And they took my camera and they took all the memory cards and they were like, what's this? You know, they accused me of being a spy. And why was I taking photographs of the desert as I was, you know? And they didn't believe that I just walked there, you know, 4,000 miles, of course.
Because who does that,
right?
Well, I'm surprised word didn't travel its way up, because when you were in like Rwanda and Uganda, you were a celebrity there, essentially.
Well, yeah, I know. Well, it did eventually. I mean, once we finally did get permissions, by the time I actually got to the end of the journey, I had like the British ambassador met me at the pyramids. The governor of Upper Egypt came to visit me. Like when I actually reached the end of the trip, there were like 10 different politicians like following me to the end. So it was quite remarkable.
Yeah.
But at the stage where I was at the border, we suddenly got the right permission to like cross a certain thing. So, as they were questioning me, I thought, the photographs on there, there's nothing too controversial, but if they see any photo, you know, I take photographs of everything from, you know, and I know there was like one photograph I've got of the Aswan Dam. And the dam itself, you know, in Egypt is a big feature of national security. I mean, it's just a dam. It's nothing particularly interesting. But, you know, they can put you into jail for something as simple as that. So I thought, okay, if they see the fact that I've taken a photograph of this dam, I'm going to be in trouble here. So I thought, I'm just going to bore them. So I just got I knew where my pictures of camels were. So I sort of flipped straight to the pictures of camels and then just spent a good 3 or 4 minutes on each photograph describing these camels ad nauseum. And these guys were getting
how many photos did you have to go through?
I took them through a lot of camel photos and a lot of deserts with my utmost enthusiasm for desert flora and fauna, by which time these guys were so bored they just didn't even get to the end. So thankfully they didn't see the photographs of mine at the dam. So I got away with that one.
Oh, man. Yeah. Let me, I ask you, of all the places that you've been to, you know, I don't want to ask you your favorite place necessarily, because that's a, it's always a difficult question to ask. It's like people asking me what my favorite fight is or something. And I always give a way different answer than what people think. But if you, your house, and you had the terrace at your house and it had to overlook one view of all the places you've ever seen in this world, which view, not actually living there, but that was just the view of your terrace, what would you choose? What's the most, the place where, I mean, I know it's happened more than once, so it's a difficult choice, but that place where you're like, wow, I'm just in awe here.
So there's a place that I keep going back to, and it's called Sarangot Hill in Nepal.
Okay.
And it overlooks it's kind of like just on the outskirts of the city of Pokhara. There's this amazing view right across the whole of the Himalayas. You can see Annapurna, Dalagiri, and all this, and it's just magnificent. If you get there for like 4 a.m. and the sun rises, it's just one of those beautiful sights in the whole world. And I've been many, many times now, and it never fails to just mesmerize me.
So that would be your backyard, essentially, then?
I think so, yeah. I think that would be my view, yeah.
Awesome. Rich, we got to find fighters down there, man. Mm.
Yeah, see,
the Gurkhas, they're good fighters. I don't know. I think they're pretty resilient guys down there.
Yeah, so for us to travel to places, we essentially have to be able to recruit. And so we're just looking for reasons to go to certain places so that we can go there and recruit athletes. That's our reason for being there. And then we just get in trouble while we're there as well, you know?
Sounds great.
Yeah. What's your dream expedition? Like one you haven't done yet or something like that? Or is there one that you would repeat that you have done? Like anywhere in the world that you haven't done yet that you're like, this is where I would like to go. This is on my wish list.
Sure. You know what? There's two expeditions I'm really, really keen to do that I haven't done yet. I mean, would I repeat an expedition? Probably not, just because, when you invest so much energy into something for months and months and months, you have that experience. I don't think you could ever repeat it.
If you had to, which one would you repeat?
If I had to, it would be the Americas, because it was like just hilarious with Alberto, my guide. It was, and also, whilst it certainly had some pretty hairy moments, there's a lot of margaritas along the way, so it's not too bad. You know? it was really fun. But I think I really, really, because I've kind of, a couple of years ago, I've always ridden motorbikes, but I never got around to like having a bike in the UK. And then a couple of years ago, I bought a motorbike, and I've kind of been like doing a bit more, a lot more trips. And I want to really do a long motorbike trip. And I think South America is a continent that's kind of eluded me so far. I've done a few small trips there, but I'd love to do a trip riding from Colombia all the way down to the southern tip of Patagonia. Whoa, whoa, whoa. I think that'd just be a spectacular trip.
Wow.
I thought you were a walker.
Well, I think I'm going to be a motorbiker now.
Because listen,
we mustn't pigeonhole ourselves.
I got a girl on my team that is that's been training walking, because I think she wants to join you on an expedition. She's got a little little crush on me.
So tell her she needs to get her bike license.
Okay, I'll let her know for sure.
Yeah, Levison, I'm curious, man. You know, kind of in line with what Rich was asking about all these different places that you're going to, when it comes to the people, right? Like one of the things that really stood out to me when you were talking about how hospitable the people were on your route to the Nile, I think the example you used was a man would be willing to divorce his wife before you rejected or before you, if you didn't accept kind of an urn of water.
Yeah, right?
Like when you entered this house, like that kind of level of hospitality. I mean, and I've been living in Asia, and we've traveled around in all these different places, and we see that, right? Mm. And, we go up to places like the Hunza Valley in Pakistan, or when we were in Mongolia, up in a gur, getting treated with all this kind of stuff. I'm curious, which place would you say kind of had the most impact on you in terms of the people and kind of how they treated you on your travels?
Probably, let me think. I think the most hospitable, probably the Middle East, actually.
Yeah.
I'd say so. I'd say going through Iraqi Kurdistan, up in the far north of Iraq, the Kurds are just, there's like this code of honor that they will just, yeah, it would be so embarrassing for them not to offer you. Even if you're their worst enemy, they'll invite you into their home, they'll feed you. And it's really special. Sudan, equally, like you mentioned there, you know, the sense of generosity is overwhelming. They would genuinely rather die than let their guest go without a drink of water. I mean, one guy, it was funny because we were walking occasionally sort of away from the villages, because every time we walked through the villages, people would run out of their homes. They would offer us water and tea and, you know, dinner. And it was kind of slowing us down. And my two camel guys are like, look, we need to hurry up because I want to get home for Ramadan. So they insisted that every other day we would walk in the desert, you know, a couple of miles away from the village, so that we weren't getting constantly bombarded by generosity, which I know sounds deeply ungrateful.
You ungrateful jerk.
Yeah, I know. Like that's the only way to make any progress. And but of course, you know, when you set up camp in the desert, you make a little campfire. The locals, they in their village, like, who's that out in the desert? So we got kind of like surrounded by all these people one night, and they're like, "What are you doing? Like, why are you camping? You know, our homes are here." And we're like, trying to explain, like, look, we're in a bit of a rush, you know, trying to walk the Nile.
the explorer angle didn't work.
And one guy, he was so offended, he stormed off, and we're like, oh, really sorry. And then he came back like half an hour later. He carried his bed on his head.
Oh my!
Brought it. He says, "If you're not going to come into my home, my home is coming to you." And I mean, that is something quite amazing. And I don't think you'd get that in London. Maybe not even in Singapore.
You for sure wouldn't get it in the US.
Anywhere.
Yeah. have you ever read Lone Survivor, Lev?
No, I watched the movie.
Oh,
I'm
man.
Embarrassed to say. I've not read
it. Yeah, it's well. Let me tell you, the movie doesn't even follow the same storyline because,
right.
You know, in the States, obviously, you know, during 9/11, I was actually teaching high school at the time when that happened. I was in the classroom when that happened, and of course, you know, the aftermath of all that and the media frenzy, and I guess like the perception of what Islam was at that time for everybody. I mean, obviously in any religious group, there are radicals, but it was actually that book, reading that book, that really, before I had done any significant travel to the Middle East, because I've done a few things with the American military. I've been to Iraq and whatnot several times. But you don't actually get to experience the customs or cultures because you're really not off the military bases all that much. But reading that book, the book is actually about how the main character, Marcus Luttrell, after the firefight, was taken in by locals, and how even though he's technically kind of an enemy, or maybe not an enemy of the people that took him in, it was how they nursed him back to health, because the U.S. military thought that he was dead. And I don't know how many months it was, 9 months maybe, that these villagers nursed him back to health and was willing to fight to the death to not let anybody from a surrounding area come in and take him or harm him. And when you learn that, when you see that kind of stuff, it's like, well, what I see in the media and then what I'm reading from this firsthand experience, and you know, even with the stuff that I've read in your books and your experiences and all that kind of stuff, is like that there's just a lot to take in from that, a lot that you can learn about that culturally and just from especially from a hospitality standpoint, like how important
humanity is.
That's what it's all about. I think that's what I find most appealing about my journeys. For me, it's never been about necessarily the physical undertaking or breaking records. I mean, that's a small part of it. For me, it's an opportunity to shine a light on parts of the world that we have, perhaps a negative stereotype or a misconception, and showing the humanity, the human stories, and telling the story from the local side, and actually in a lot of these places, whether it's in the narco neighborhoods of Honduras in Central America, or whether it's in places like Sudan, where we sort of associate with famine or corruption or war, or Afghanistan or wherever it might be. Of course, all that stuff happens. There's no smoke without fire. But, what we see in the media is a small fraction of what's really going on. And even in Syria, when I was in Syria 2 years ago, it's what struck me the most is going into Damascus, into the old city there. And, this is a war zone. This was when ISIS was on the gates of the city. There was, you could literally hear the mortars and the bombs dropping 2 miles away. And yet life was just going on. There's people in the streets having a coffee. There was wine bars open. There's restaurants. There's even a couple of nightclubs we went to. Thought you're going clubbing in Syria, Damascus. All the while you could hear the bombs dropping. I thought this is the most surreal experience. And the markets were open, and even the tourist shops with the carpets and all that stuff. And I couldn't help but ask this one guy who's selling carpets. He's like, "How's business?" He was like, "Oh, I haven't sold a carpet in 7 years since the war started." I was like, what are you doing open?" He's like, "Well, it gets me away from the wife and blah, blah, blah."
How does he support the family?
Yeah, but it was a sense of hope. And that's what gets these people through. It's like, he knows that he's not realistically going to sell a carpet, but he said, "Look, I've not sold a carpet in 7 years, but the tourists will come back. Maybe not today, maybe not tomorrow, but they will come back." And people keep their shops open. They get to work. They have this sense of resilience and stoicism. And that's why they kept the bars open. And people are clubbing while you hear the bombs going off. And that was, the people get married and life goes on. And that's the point that I was trying to make, was there are millions and millions of people living in Syria. And whilst that's not to negate the tragedy of what's gone on with the war, you've got to also remember the people that are just trying to get on with their normal lives.
Yeah, that's kind of the experience I had when we landed in Pakistan, because we flew into Lahore. I don't know if all of Pakistan is as developed as Lahore is, but Lahore is a very well-engineered city, laid out, wide highways, very commercialized. Mm. And I haven't spent a ton of time on that part of the world, at least yet. Been to a couple stand countries, but just that's not a part of the world I'm highly traveled in yet. And I just remember when I landed there, I don't know really what I expected, but it was not what I expected. I actually have this really cool picture of me. Our quote unquote guide was my matchmaker. He's from Pakistan, actually. So we have this nice built-in guide, and he had spent time in the area where we were. And we ate at this, Jonathan and I, the whole group of us ate at this rooftop bar that used to be a brothel. Really cool story, backstory. The owner was the son of one of the former prostitutes that worked at this brothel, ended up buying it. But I'm standing on the
and it's right next to the Badshahi temple, the mosque.
Exactly.
Yeah. And so that's the whole thing. I'm standing on this roof of this temple, and I'm standing next to this statue of a Virgin Mary. There's the Badshahi mosque behind me. And I distinctly remember, it was a really nice night, cool night, perfect night for a rooftop dinner. The call to prayer was going off at that time. And then on the backside of the Badshahi Mosque was a Christian church. And then to the right was a Sikh temple.
Yeah.
And I just remember thinking, I'm in a place where Pakistan's probably, 99% Muslim or something, or at least high 90s. And I didn't expect that kind of diversity in a place like that, based on the media that I had seen as growing up and whatnot in a place like that. I don't know if I was expecting bullet ridden buildings or whatever, but so it's a similar kind of experience to what you're talking about.
Yeah. It's eye opening, isn't it? And it's kind of those stories that I think need to come out more and show people that we shouldn't just always accept firsthand what we kind of see. Because we all fall foul of having prejudices and stereotypes. And I think we should always be vigilant to try and look beyond that and see the reality.